Good evening. I'm Lynn Singer, Deputy Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs at Case Western Reserve University. And it gives me really great pleasure and pride tonight to welcome you here on behalf of the Laura and Alvin Siegel Lifelong Learning Program at Case Western Reserve for the first of our four-part series on substance abuse, Confronting Addiction. As you know, we are seeing an epidemic of heroin addiction of incredible proportions, with 300 people who have died of heroin or fentanyl overdoses in Cuyahoga County alone in 2016. And this is much higher than the previous 2015 total, which was 228 people. Just horrible. Only a few years ago, I think many of us believed that heroin addictions had disappeared or belonged somewhere far off in some distant time for others. Addiction is an illness and one that we must understand, educate ourselves about, and treat. Heroin addiction is particularly deadly and hard to treat, making prevention efforts paramount. Educating ourselves and our children is key, and that is why we are here today. We are particularly grateful to Cheryl and Dennis Hirsch, who started the Melissa Ray Fund in support of advocacy to increase our understanding of this epidemic that's impacting our community, and which supports tonight's program in memory of their daughter who succumbed to this illness. If you believe this is an important endeavor, please consider a contribution to that fund. Now, it's my great pleasure to introduce our moderator of all of our upcoming additional three sessions, including today, and that is Vince Caraffi, chair of the Cuyahoga County Opiate Task Force. Vince Caraffi has worked for the Cuyahoga County Board of Health for 26 years, with the last 13 years as supervisor within the Environmental Health Division. He concurrently serves as the chair of the Cuyahoga County Opiate Task Force, partnering with the Ohio Department of Health to address and stop the epidemic rise in opiate abuse within our county. Mr. Caraffi has sought to build successful partnerships at the local, state, and national levels to address emerging challenges in the present non-traditional public health issues that we're facing. Starting in 2004, he's worked on the following issues: injury and violence issues, safety and falls among the elderly, increased fatalities as a result of the opioid epidemic and the misuse of opiate pain medication, hoarding, and gun violence. In 2010, he became a member of a work group with Safe States and the National Association of City and County Health Officials to develop standards and indicators for local health department injury and violence prevention programs. I feel like I'm going to knock this over. In 2011, he was asked to participate on the development of Ohio's first strategic plan to prevent falls among the elderly. By adopting and implementing this strategic plan, the state of Ohio is now able to secure additional priority federal funding from the Centers for Disease Control Prevention for injury and violence prevention programming. So we're very lucky to have Mr. Caraffi. He received his master's in public health from Cleveland State University in 2004, and is a master's degree candidate in social work, so he can better understand individuals and families dealing with the illness of substance abuse. Mr. Caraffi is also, and he was there at 7 o'clock this morning, an adjunct professor at Baldwin-Wallace University, teaching in the public health program. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Caraffi.
Thank you very much. I want to welcome everybody here, and I want to start out kind of with a story. I think that in many cases, in public health and also in medicine, we focus on data. We focus on issues of mortality or morbidity. But probably about 2 years ago, I received a call from a woman who, out of the blue, wanted to tell me her family story. And I think one of the things that we really need to represent and one of the things that we really need to continue to share in regards to substance abuse is family stories. And Cheryl had contacted me early one one morning, and we decided to meet for a cup of coffee. And what that turned into was really talking about what her family could do, and really talk about the tragedy that her family experienced, but also build upon that to increase awareness in the community. And I can't tell you whether it's Cheryl's family, Robbie Brandt's family, talking about this issue is essential. When you look back at the historical perspective of focus on addiction, it's always pretty much anonymous. People are afraid to talk about addiction, especially heroin addiction. I have addiction in my family, and I was telling our panelists earlier, you know, my mom has a guilt, but we need to talk about that. And I want to really say thank you again to Cheryl and her husband. Last year's session was fantastic. I enjoyed being part of that, and I enjoy being part of this today. Before we get into the panel session, I do want to just talk about some things that we've seen locally. You know, if anybody read Cleveland.com today, August was probably one of the worst months we've ever experienced in regards to fentanyl overdoses in Cuyahoga County. Cuyahoga County is not the only county that's plagued by this, I can tell you that. 2 weeks ago, I think it was Akron. 10 days ago, it was Cincinnati, Hamilton County. So it is a huge challenge that we're facing. It's a public health crisis that in my time period, I've never experienced before, folks. I mean, we're talking in some cases close to a 500% increase in fatalities. That's amazing. That is a public health crisis. Some of the other things I want to share with you from our partners on the street, the things that I've heard before we get into our panelists. From what I hear, this is from police force, from what I hear in groups, heroin is available. Law enforcement officers stated to me a couple weeks ago, heroin's a now thing, it's mainstream, you can get it anywhere. The majority of people that are taking are primarily white, male and females from the suburbs, okay? When I was in high school, nobody was using it. In many cases now, 14 and 50 year old kids are getting it. You know, heroin's just as easy to get as beer. That's pretty striking. You know, I grew up in Strongsville, graduated from Strongsville High School in 1985. I never saw heroin. I never saw heroin when I was at OU either. It's striking that it's everywhere. And I think some of the big problems that we're facing is there's still some people out there in some communities that aren't willing to accept that. State trends, what we're looking at, the number of unintentional drug overdose in Ohio increased again in 2015, driven mostly by the rise in fentanyl-related deaths. The number of fentanyl-related deaths in Ohio has increased from 84 in 2013 to 503 in 2014 and rose to 1,155 in 2015. That's a striking increase in regards to the number of people that are actually dying from this illicit drug that we're seeing on the street. The one thing I do want to say is, you know, it was mentioned earlier, I've worked in public health for 26 years, and I've never experienced the challenge that's so complex as this specific issue. I've worked in many different issues in public health, but the one thing I do want to say is I'm very proud of the number of people that are out there, several of them that are in the audience right here, that are really working to try and address this issue. Hopefully what we'll see in the near future is a reduction. You know, one of the things that I'm really looking at is maybe we should be looking at addiction as a whole. You know, the report that just came out this month through Dr. Gilson, we had a sharp increase in deaths associated with cocaine, collateral damage from alcohol that we still see on the streets today. Why is it that the United States has such an issue dealing with substance abuse? It's something that's become very interesting to me. I want to thank everybody here again for coming. I think it's important, the more people that we have here, to speak on the subject matter. And what I'm going to do here is actually let the panelists introduce themselves. We'll start from the left to the right, and then we'll go ahead and get into presentations. I know that we're going to be collecting questions. I'll be more than happy once the panelists are done to try to get as many questions as we have in there from the audience. So we're going to go ahead and get started. Dr. Jerry.
Hi, I'm Jason Jerry. I'm an addiction psychiatrist and a staff physician at the Cleveland Clinic's Alcohol and Drug Recovery Center. I'm also an assistant professor of medicine at the Cleveland Clinic Lerner College of Medicine of Case Western Reserve. The rest of my bio is in your handout, so I won't recap that.
Hi, my name's Leigh Taylor. I'm a fourth-year doctoral student at the Mandel School at Case Western Reserve University. I came to Cleveland from an addictions counselor background, and so I bring both practice and a curiosity in how to research addiction and the impact of addiction on families.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth Tracy. I'm a faculty member at the Jack Joseph and Morton Mandel School of Applied Social Science. It has a very long name, and it has a long history. We're celebrating our 100th anniversary or birthday. These little flyers are out in the desk. We're having a block party, which you're welcome to come to. I know you don't think of social workers as party people, but we're going to try for this event. And in my role at the school, I was fortunate a few years ago to be part of a faculty development program to learn more about substance abuse, because prior to that, many social workers didn't have that kind of training and expertise. And since then, I want to share with you with Leigh tonight is what we learned from working with women who were in treatment programs here in Cleveland about their social networks and how their networks helped or hindered. And I'll just say as a disclaimer, there are two people associated with this project. One is Sharon Cohen, who was the project manager when we had this going, and Lynn Singer was a co-investigator on the study. So you know we will be very truthful, right?
Thank you very much. You know, the one thing I would like to say before, you know, Dr. Jerry starts, we had talked earlier before we came up on the panel, and I think collaboration is key. You know, one of the things that I've done and have diligently done as the chair of the task force is try to learn. And one of the benefits of having such a collective group of individuals that are committed is being able to call each other. And I can't tell you how much I enjoy if it's 7 o'clock in the morning, if I have a question pertaining to treatment, or maybe a mother or a father are calling me and I can't answer the question. I know I can forward that over to Dr. Jerry, Dr. Chris Delis-Reos. So partnerships are key. I think from the standpoint of this epidemic and other public health issues, if we're focusing on chronic disease, one agency and one individual can't do this. And I think that's something I really want to put across to everybody in the crowd. Collaboration is key to solving this. Dr. Jerry.
All right. So, yeah, I think when we talk about the heroin epidemic here and we see what's going on here in Cleveland, sometimes there's this impending sense of doom that things just aren't going to get better, that this is a hopeless situation, that the numbers just continue to skyrocket. And while that might be true for the moment, I think we also have to keep in mind that this is an epidemic that, like other epidemics that preceded it, will pass. Okay, for those of us who were around in the 70s and 80s, you know, we remember the crack cocaine epidemic. And at that time, we thought the sky was falling. And we thought that crack was going to be the downfall of this city and perhaps the country. But that epidemic came and went in the 90s. You know, crack cocaine is still around. We still see it every now and then. But that's not the mainstay of what I do in treatment or what most addictionologists do in treatment. Okay, it's no longer of epidemic proportions. So I think it's important to keep that in mind. And with heroin, this is not our first heroin epidemic. And you know, Cheryl had put in a special request that I talk a little bit about some of the history of opiates. But opiates have been around for a long, long time. In fact, they've been around for over 5,000 years. They were the opium poppy was first cultivated by the Mesopotamians back in 3400 BC. People soon realized the euphoric potential of the plant, as the ancient Sumerians referred to it as the joy plant. So I'm pretty sure they were abusing it even back then. Hippocrates was the first to realize that it might have medicinal benefit. And then if you fast forward to the 1800s, morphine was first isolated and synthesized commercially as an isolate of opium for the treatment of pain in the early 1800s. This was thought to be a great medical achievement, a great advance over, you know, previous choices that were available for pain. And it was one of the greatest developments, or so they thought, of the 1800s until they realized its addictive potential. In the Civil War in the 1860s, a lot of soldiers were coming back from war addicted to morphine. And so researchers landed upon diacetylmorphine, better known as heroin. They called it heroin because they truly thought it was going to be a tremendous advancement over morphine, that it was really going to be a heroin and that it would have all the pain-killing effects of morphine, but yet it wouldn't be addictive. They really thought that because this drug had to be broken down by the body first in order to have its effect, that that was going to decrease its addictive potential. And of course, we know that's not the case. So by the end of the 1800s and into the early 1900s, we were in the grips of our first opiate epidemic. Heroin was available over-the-counter in a lot of cough medicines. Other opiates were also available in those over-the-counter cough medicines and that. And a lot of people were getting addicted to it. Mostly a lot of middle-class and upper-middle-class white women who were getting hooked on this. it was in the early 1900s that a lot of doctors were just scrambling, trying to figure out what to do for these poor women and how to help them. And a lot of them were prescribing opiates in their office, thinking that, hey, at least if I'm prescribing it, I'll have some control over it. We can keep an eye on things and keep their addiction under control. And in 1914, the feds passed the Harrison Narcotics Tax Act, which, although technically a tax act, there was a provision in it that forbade doctors from prescribing narcotics to known narcotics addicts. And so there were actually several doctors who were incarcerated at the time for violating that act and, you know, in their efforts to help some of these women. By the way, that act or the provisions of it are still in effect today. We can't prescribe narcotics for addiction treatment purposes to known narcotics addicts. As a result of that, there are only a couple of exceptions, methadone and buprenorphine being the two major exceptions to that rule. So after my point is that after 1914, there was really not a lot available to treat the addiction problem that was going on during that epidemic. There were some municipalities around the country, about 50 of them, that were doing morphine maintenance clinics. These were run by like sheriff's offices and that kind of thing. And as you can imagine, these were not successful. As the Harry Anslinger, the previous commissioner of the Bureau of Narcotics, once stated, these were essentially bar rooms for addicts. And these were shut down in the 1920s. In the 1930s, the feds came up with an idea to start what was called the Federal Narcotics Farm. It was a specialized prison of 1,500 beds. The best known one was in Lexington, Kentucky, and then there was a sister facility in Fort Worth, Texas. These were actually amazing facilities. These had resources that would have been the envy of any modern-day abstinence-based addiction treatment program. Although they were prisons, they were set up really like treatment centers. The first week was devoted to detox, and then after that, they had group therapy, they had individual therapy, they had vocational rehab, they had medical support, psychiatric support, you name it, they had it. And they also had voluntary patients. So not only would they funnel people who were part of the prison system from around the country when they were identified as having a problem with heroin, they also would take people off the streets because there really were no resources for addiction treatment then. So people were actually checking themselves into prison, if you can believe that. There were involuntary commitment laws that were passed in Kentucky in the 1940s that then allowed them to commit those voluntary individuals to up to a one-year length of stay. I say that because we would never get a one-year length of stay in treatment these days. We fight and beg with the insurance companies, you know, to get days or maybe a couple weeks in treatment. So all of this put together, they had everything that we could ever want in an abstinence-based program. And you would think that their outcomes were stellar. But what was shown during the years that those systems operated from 1935 to 1974 was that about 95% of patients relapsed after discharge, most of them within the first 6 months. And this is really what got people, again, revisiting the idea of maintenance treatment or medication-assisted treatment in the 1960s. And that's what prompted Dole and Neiswanger to take a look at methadone. Okay, methadone was the first medication that was approved for medication-assisted treatment. And really what they were looking at or looking for with such a medication is not one that would just substitute for the drug that they were abusing and get them high. You want a drug that at normal therapeutic doses doesn't get one high, but keeps one from going into withdrawal, while at the same time blocking their receptors in the case that somebody comes around with the old substance so that they don't get high off of it, and then keeps them from craving. Essentially, it keeps them feeling normal enough to stay in treatment long enough to achieve long-lasting recovery. Okay, and that was what was available up until 2002 when buprenorphine, which was previously available for pain management in this country, became available and was approved for addiction treatment. The nice thing about buprenorphine, better known as Suboxone, is that for the first time, addicts didn't have to go down to methadone clinics to receive their daily dose. Okay, usually, methadone clinics, you'll have only a couple of them in a city the size of ours. They're not in the they're in the not-so-nice parts of town, and to try to get somebody reintegrated into society, back to work, you know, get their home life back in order and all of that, while having to go down to get their daily dose at the methadone clinic is not really feasible for most folks. So Suboxone was a tremendous advancement in that regard, in that for the first time it allowed addicts to be treated in the privacy of their doctor's office and receive a prescription for their disease just like any other person dealing with any other illness would receive a prescription. It helped a lot to reduce the stigma attached to this illness, and you know, we'll talk some more about this in the Q&A and about medication-assisted treatment. But I think the bottom line in all of this, again, is that these epidemics come and go. This one will also pass eventually. You know, I think sometimes we get frustrated and we think that we're not doing anything, but I think we are. I think we're getting the word out there, and I think some changes have been made. I mean, you see federal legislation now out there that's addressing this. You know, people for the first time are talking about supporting medication-assisted treatment, doing whatever they can to expand treatment. The conversation's going. And I think in that regard, this has put a spotlight on addictions in general and not just the opiate epidemic.
I think what we'll end up doing is we'll have question and answers for all three panelists after we're done. Is that what you'd like to do, Sean? Does that work? Okay. All right. Thank you very much. So our next speakers, one of the things also when we talk about learning, we had an opportunity, I think it was in early this year, where the governor's task force had come up to Cuyahoga County to speak with us on some things as far as what we could do locally here to help stem some of the things that we're seeing as far as fatalities in the street. One of the things that I was completely unaware of was the difference in services for women and men, especially for women who are in our institutional, our correctional facilities, as far as it relates to their recovery. And I think it's really important, and I'm really excited to hear this presentation, because we're also looking at trying to stem some of the collateral damage associated with this disease and some of those gaps in services that are there. And I think it's interesting to me, I've been doing this for quite some time, and there's still quite a number of things out there that I learn as I go forward. So I'm really looking forward to this presentation. I'm not sure which one of you wanted to start, so go ahead.
Well, just to orient you a little bit to our work, we studied women who were in treatment. We followed them for a year after they started treatment, and we looked at their social networks. And social networks refers to the set of individuals and the ties among them for these women. And as we know, women face a number of challenges in recovery. And as you can see, they're often surrounded by people who are not supportive of the treatment process, maybe users themselves, enablers in their families and friends. They enter treatment with more family stress. They have a think about, you know, child care. They're often responsible for the children, and they have more strains on their personal networks than men. And so building network resources can be a challenging treatment goal while they're receiving care. And one of the things that we knew as we started was that there wasn't much known about how women's networks change over time and how they continue to change after they've received treatment. And so we gathered information. We followed 377 women from three area treatment programs. And we interviewed them at 1 month and 6 months and 12 months after they entered treatment. And we used a software program, and it helped them identify their personal social networks. And as you can see, they were able to create lists and really think about who they knew and how. And so each woman was asked to list 25 names and the details about those individuals, their characteristics, and then how they knew each other. And we're going to tell the story of one woman and how her network changed over the year post-treatment.
So this is a woman who was in residential treatment. She was in her mid-30s, which was pretty typical for the women that we were talking with. And the way you read this map is those colored shapes represent people. So those are people in the network. I kind of look at this and I think, well, what would my network look like? In fact, when we first started the study, we all did our own network map so we could see what it looked like. The lines between the shapes are relationships. So if two people have a relationship, they talk with each other, they have a connected line between each other. And then we use color to show how the person was known by the woman who gave us this information. And so in this chart, the main ones are the blue that you see. Let's see if I can do this at an angle. She has one main, is it doing? Oh, you have to put your finger down on it. She has one main component of her network. All these blue dots are all family members. And then she has another component that are red. It indicates people from a treatment program, although it looks orange on this slide, and the purple, which is supposed to be pink, they're treatment professionals. So she's got this group of treatment professionals and this group of family. And already, if you've been through the experience of a chronic illness with anybody, you can see that who are separated. The professionals and the family members are really separated in this system. And for this woman, which was very typical, this person here is a bridging person. So all these treatment people have to go through this person. And this person is a male close friend who was also a substance user. And we use the shapes over here. Circles indicate people that the woman had used with. So we ask this of each of the people that the people listed in their network. And for this woman, she's got, I think, four circles here. So four family members are people that she used with. And this was not uncommon. And we wondered, are these people going to stay there a year from now? What's going to happen with those other substance users in the network? Way over on the side, which I think, well, I guess I can get it to go over. Those two people over there are very important. They're not connected with the network at all. You don't see a line between them and anyone else. So they're called isolates. And what we found was that was a very protective thing. They also have the diamond shape to them. So these are people who are not substance users. They're not someone that the woman has used with. And what we found out over time is that women who had isolates who were not substance users, kind of separated from their network, they did better over time. At 12 months, they were less likely to have used substances. We didn't know that at the beginning of the study, but that was one of the things we found out. This woman also has, way down here, two friends that are connected. And they also have the diamond shape, so it means those friends are not users. And we found that support from friends and also support from family. The women reported a lot of support from family, even family members who might also be substance users. But friend support was very important over time. All right, so do you have the gist of how to read these network maps? Here she is at 6 months. And what I'm happy to say at 6 months is that she's out of treatment at this point, and she reports no substance use. But what we see is one big network of family. Where did the treatment people go? Where did the professionals go that this woman had worked with? So you can see the importance of family support over time, because family and friends remain. She still has the one isolate way up here in the corner, up there, who's a non-user, so that's still there for her. And the person who was that critical person to her, critical in terms of being very important, is no longer in the network. He's way over here in this corner, which was probably a good thing in terms of that relationship. Then at 12 months, so this is a year later, the network really hasn't changed much. From 6 months. It's still largely family. And overall, we found that if there were going to be changes in the network, it was that early six-month period that it was more likely to happen. We still find that professionals and peers from treatment declined over time, and they stayed low over time. This was pretty consistent. All the connections that you see, all the lines that you see here, That's really a good thing, because we did find that closely connected networks, the women who had that kind of closely connected network, they were less likely to be using substances at 12 months. Again, we didn't expect that necessarily, but that's one of the things that we found. But the thing that is most challenging, I think, for women in recovery is that, remember the circles, the blue circles of people who use, they're still there. If you count them up, there's still four of them in there. And that was true for a lot of women. And so we found that the women with fewer substance users in their network did better. I guess everyone would expect that. But we found that even women that had those substance users in their network, they weren't necessarily people they could disconnect with. It might be a family member that they really relied on for transportation or childcare. So it's not like you could say, I'm never going to see you again. But they had to manage those relationships. And that's what Leigh is going to talk about, the qualitative findings and what women told us about how they manage their networks.
And so women's stories, of course, are incredibly powerful and interesting. And it was amazing how many women reflected how much they learned just by doing these mapping exercises. And this woman said, what she learned from being asked about her network was, my son needs to see the new people in my life and my friends today. He said something that hit me like a ton of bricks. When they asked him, how will you know if your mother is using? He said, by the company she keeps. My understanding of recovery is that it's an act of change. And if I am not connecting the dots, that social part of me, then I'm not going to grow or change. And that's what's interesting. Women recognized that they needed to take action and that they would make conscious choices about who was in their circle and why they were there. And so we did. We asked them about their networks and what they did and how they changed over time. And what they told us was that they did a variety of things. They'd limit contact with certain people. Sometimes they would be reaching out and establishing new relationships. Or they talked about maintaining and rebuilding relationships with friends or family. And oftentimes it was a disconnect, removing people from their networks completely. And women also noted how they changed the way that they interacted with others. So a lot of times it was about becoming more open. And for others, it was about becoming more isolated. But these are their voices. And so in their own words, the women told us things like, I choose not to add anyone to my circle. Or about how they did establish new relationships. One woman said, I've reached out to more people for help in my recovery. And another noted that she was changing how she interacts, telling us that she had stepped out of her comfort zone and was meeting people from all different walks of life. And of course, through the disconnections, we often heard things like, I removed people from my network that weren't good for me. Or I've taken away the dread friends and I've added family. And so it's through their stories that we realize that, yes, the networks do change. And to kind of put it into context tonight, their voices are their story, and we're all part of somebody's network. And so what we did, we brought along a sheet of resources, and it's out at the front desk, of not only some local agencies that you can contact, Al-Anon, Alcoholics Anonymous, but also a variety of internet sources that can link you up with just about anything you might need if there's somebody in your network who might need help.
Well, thank you all. We have several questions from the audience, so we'll go ahead and get into that. But I think it's interesting when you start talking about the networks and what networks are there to help. I think in many cases, some of the challenges that we face, you know, when you're talking to people on the streets, some families who can't get services. You know, I've heard stories of individuals giving their kids money to get Suboxone on the street, unfortunately, until they found a place. Close family members of mine couldn't find a place until something opened up in Ashtabula. And we were talking a little bit earlier about that and how families are needed and how families are there to support, but also some of the challenges associated with that. I guess you could call it the peaks and valleys of dealing with addiction, the guilt, you know, maybe children taking advantage of you, when those opportunities come, you know, how do you approach that? How do you put your best foot forward? It's a very, very difficult situation. It's quite complex, like I said before, and trying to deal with family is even more challenging from the professionals that, you know, I've asked these questions to. So we're going to go ahead and get into some questions here. I think we're pretty good on time, so. This is actually for each panelist. Will each panelist please tell us how or why they became interested in addiction, and is it personal?
Okay. For me, it was for a multitude of reasons. I trained at a very busy county hospital, kind of like a metro times 5 or 10 down in Miami. And in our emergency room, or our psychiatric emergency room, and on our units, we dealt with a lot of addictions, and we had a very busy detox unit. I got very, very used to that, and really enjoyed working with addicts in that setting. I also liked all of the psychopharmacology involved with addictions. That to me was very fascinating, also too, yes, some personal experience. I feel that I was headed down the wrong road and got off that bus early, before it, you know, before I mounted consequences and wound up with bigger problems. So I feel like I can empathize with my patients and have an understanding of what they're going through in a lot of ways. So for all of those reasons, I went into addictions, and I can tell you that, you know, being in the field, I don't know of any other area of medicine or psychiatry in which we see such dramatic transformations as we do in the field of addictions. I see people that come in the front door that look like, you know, pardon my expression, but complete train wrecks. Their life is in complete disarray. Physically, they're not healthy. And you see them a couple years later, and they're looking great. They've got their life back. They've got a twinkle in their eye that they didn't have before. And that's nice to see. And I think staying focused on those success stories makes up for the tragedies that we also see.
I did come into the field of social work because addiction has touched my life in a number of ways, and I stayed in the field for similar reasons. There's nothing quite as inspiring as being around a group of people who feel like their lives are at their end, their lives have no meaning, and to work with them through the process of recovery. And to become the people maybe that they always felt that they could be or were scared to be. So that's why I stay in addictions. And it is difficult, both as a professional, and I've struggled as a professional in the field, and I've struggled personally in the field. We all have, it. Like I said, it touches our lives in different ways. But I'm happy to be here, and I'm always happy to learn.
I didn't start off as a social worker in addictions, and the master's program that I went to didn't even have an addictions track or courses. So I ended up as a social worker in Seattle, Washington, with virtually no experience in addictions, and I was in child welfare. And then I discovered that, of course, substance abuse was a lot of the reasons why parents were not able to parent their children. And I quickly got some training. And I mentioned in my introduction that I was very fortunate to be part of a faculty development program so that we as a faculty could be better at teaching social workers, you know, to work in this area and to do research in this area as well. I would have to say that it's only recently that I've had experiences on my sister's side of the family, and it was a very difficult situation that she faced with her son and her son's and his wife. But the only thing I could do was make sure that the children were safe. That's the one thing that I could counsel my sister on, and so I knew that the children were safe. But it was a very difficult situation. Talking with so many of the women in this study, there was one woman, and it always struck me. You know, when they finished the four interviews, I think we had about 81% of the women finished all four interviews. And when they did, we gave them a little recognition for that. And one woman said, you know, this is the first thing in my life that I've finished. And so I realized that by doing this, you know, research, we were really doing an intervention because we were helping people to kind of see their lives and see that they could take some control over parts of their life. Not always easy, though. Not always easy.
Very good. You know, I mean, from my standpoint, being in public health, we're more population-based. And, you know, with the addiction in my family, and it's interesting, the way that I look at it from learning from all these other individuals, I vividly remember hanging up on my brother when he would call from Lebanon State Institution. And I think back now when I'm going to class and I hear about family networking and stories like this. But I think from my standpoint, it's, I don't even know how some people get my, you know, my private phone line just to call up and say, hey, I was able to grab a naloxone kit. Hey, thanks for hooking me up with Emily Metz, Jeff Capretto, who from Web Task Force said, hey, I was able to get somebody into detox down at Rosary Hall. So it's a little different mindset from my traditional mind of public health and being population-based, and it's gratifying to help people out. And it's one of the things that I really focus on with individuals is there's no better feeling than helping an individual or a family out. It really is. Next question, I think, Dr. Jerry, this would be you, is what is your feeling about long-term, many years, medicated-assisted treatment, and can you equate that to, I guess it would be insulin treatment for diabetics?
Okay. Wow. I wonder if whoever asked that question has heard me talk about this before, because I oftentimes compare it with, you know, prescribing things like glucophage for diabetes. You know, I think sometimes when we say we're going to keep somebody on medication, perhaps indefinitely, you know, there's a much different reaction, far different reaction when we talk about medications used for addictions or for psychiatric disorders, for that matter, than when we talk about medications used for physical ailments. So, no, I don't see it as being a lot different. You know, I mean, with glucophage, for instance, through the appropriate diet and exercise regimen, you know, it's feasible to sometimes get off of something like glucophage. However, very few people do, and most people expect that they'll be taking it forever. With medication-assisted treatment with Suboxone, for instance, you know, I tell all my patients the same thing. Look, I don't have a crystal ball here. I don't know. And a lot of that depends on how much you immerse yourself in treatment. You know, in the end, I still believe this is all about the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous and working a solid 12-step-based program. And the folks that I've seen who are successful in getting off of Suboxone or methadone, for that matter, are the ones that are really eating, sleeping, breathing the 12 steps. And they're the ones that come into my office, you know, a couple few years into this and say, hey, look, doc, you know, I'm doing way more than the minimum. I'm going to 4, 5, 6 meetings a week. Not only do I have a sponsor, but I have several sponsees that I'm working with now. This is really, you know, this is my life. I'd like to look at tapering off of the Suboxone. That's the individual that I know is going to be successful when I taper them off. But some studies have been clear in demonstrating that when that decision is dictated by the patient, the outcomes are better. When it's dictated by the physician, it doesn't work very well. So look out if, you know, if you have a loved one who's seeing somebody who's prescribing Suboxone to them who, you know, 1 year into treatment says, okay, as per our protocol, you're coming off now. We're going to start tapering you down. That's not the appropriate way of doing things. That decision really should be patient-driven.
Yeah, I think that's a, you know, a really good question. I'm sorry about that. A really good question. When we start looking at, if we're focusing on this and we talk about this being a disease and a chronic disease, and I've heard several, you know, Dr. Jerry do this, Dr. Chris, talk about how come we don't look at this disease in parity, you know, with other chronic diseases, you know. I get, I don't pay much attention to some of the comments in Cleveland.com, but when you have people talking about how come we're giving naloxone to these people, you know, they made a decision to do that. Well, I mean, if you look at some standpoint, if we're looking at individuals who don't eat properly, individuals who continue to smoke, we treat them with respect, we treat them, and we don't ask those questions. So I think trying to get people to understand that this is a disease is very important. I think all three of you could probably answer this. And are there significant differences in substance abuse parameters for lower socioeconomic class users, middle class users, and the number of deaths or recovery and abstinence? And I would probably say, too, if we could be inclusive of those special populations, you know, pregnant women or women in general who are dealing with recovery. So do you want to start? We'll end with Dr. Jerry.
Well, I'm going to stick with women and And I'll speak to the ones who I was working with in practice before I came to Cleveland, and I'll start there. I worked with women of low socioeconomic status without health insurance. And treatment for them was incredibly difficult. We couldn't find treatment for them. They were very reliant on our services, and they could only see us once a week. And it was addressing stigma, the stigma of addiction for them, and most of them were alcoholics. And so even in light of the heroin epidemic that we're dealing with, alcoholism is still an incredibly large problem. And so for me, it was dealing with those barriers to treatment among poor women and their families.
Not sure quite where to start with this. I'll say now, treatment resources across the board are very limited. It's very difficult to get people into treatment, especially effective treatment. We have more opportunities now, I would say, with the passage of the ACA, the Affordable Care Act, a couple of years ago. What we've noticed since then is that there are actually more resources now for Medicaid folks to get into appropriate Suboxone treatment, for instance. When we have those folks come into our detox unit, you know, I can get them set up on Suboxone and transferred out to some of the more reputable community mental health centers like Signature Health, for instance, who will accept their Medicaid and who actually do treatment the right way. They have an intensive outpatient program. They have a multitude of services. It's not just about the medication, and that's really the way it ought to be done. That's the way we do it in our center. So I would say the Medicaid folks in that realm have resources that are really equal, if not better, than those with commercial insurance. I have a very difficult time getting folks with commercial insurance into Suboxone treatment providers in the community. We can take care of them while they're under our care in our programming, but after that, most of the people prescribing the medication in the community, unfortunately, are cash-only providers. That's a real problem. You know, this is evidence-based treatment. This saves lives, and yet it's the way that it's regulated has created a niche that has allowed, you know, doctors to just open up cash-only practices. And I don't have a favorable opinion of doing things that way. I understand why they do. You know, it's not just about being entrepreneurial, but it also has to do with the fact that when you're prescribing this medication, insurance companies, for instance, make you go through a prior authorization process before they will agree to pay for the prescription. And so my secretary, for instance, probably spends 70% of her time doing nothing but processing prior authorizations. If I were in private practice, I might have second thoughts about dealing with insurance for that reason. You know, I wouldn't want to hire on extra staff. So I hope that answers the question. If you can think of any other specifics.
No, yeah, I mean, I can't. It's a difficult question. I think that, you know, one of the things that we see across the United States is lack of, you know, availability for treatment. I mean, we hear that consistently, even when the state comes up here as far as access.
Right.
And it's...
Well, I think the other problem that we have, and it's not just a local problem, but a lot of the halfway houses are not accepting of medication-assisted treatment, which is unfortunate. And then also there's a polarization even in the field of addictions in which I started in this area, so I understand it, but there are a lot of these, you know, 28-day treatment programs around the country, the traditional residential rehab programs. And I think they send the wrong message. As we've said before, we're dealing with a chronic illness, and yet that model treats this like an acute problem. So somebody comes in a moment of crisis, really wants help, and the solution seems to be to put them on an airplane, send them down to South Florida or California to one of these 28-day programs. And I think the idea or the thought that a lot of people are left with is that when their loved one comes home, they'll essentially be cured. Maybe they'll have to go to a couple few meetings, but for the most part, they'll be cured. And nothing could be further from the truth. And unfortunately, about 40% of the people that wind up in the medical examiner's office, and this is going back to 2007, had a recent period of abstinence. So either they had just gotten out of treatment, had just gotten out of detox, or just came out of prison. But it's a risky period of time, and I think that needs to change as well. You know, we need to focus more on treating this as the chronic disease that it is and treating them lifelong.
One thing I would say about women is that there are many barriers often for their seeking treatment, childcare being the primary one. They fear that they will lose their children if they get into a treatment program, so that's a big barrier. And there's a somewhat more shame and stigma around women and substance abuse than a lot of women perceive that more so. And then there's also issue of trauma. Many of the women that we talked with had enormous amounts of traumatic events happen to them. We had a list of like 30 events, and some people had almost all of those events happen to them. Any one of them would throw us under the rug, and yet they were dealing with their addiction plus all the feelings around these events. So all the women we talked to were low income, and they were in our wonderful county-funded programs, and they were getting specialized treatment for women where they were dealing with the trauma along with the addiction and 12-step kinds of activities, and their kids were also getting services. And so that was a wonderful, very, very much, you know, very much needed resource that we have.
And I would say one more thing, and on a positive note, one of the areas where I think we've made progress in treatment over the last few years is that more treatment providers are getting comfortable in accepting pregnant women who are addicted to opiates. This was something that for years a lot of us shied away from, and I'm guilty of that as well. Before I came to the clinic, I avoided taking care of pregnant women because I was worried about liability, or I had this perception that there was this increased liability. And really, I think we need to get over that. I did, and I can tell you that treating pregnant women has become one of the most gratifying parts of what I do, or one of the areas of what I do. But I think around the city, we have a lot more resources now than we ever did before for treating pregnant women. I can actually refer pregnant women to a lot of different providers, and I think that's extremely helpful.
Yeah, our next program.
Excellent.
Talk about the moms program and some of the work that she's done with pregnant moms and their children. So it's pretty interesting. We just had at our last task force meeting the social worker who runs the program, and then one of the women who has been through the program and in recovery, and it was a powerful story.
She'll be joining us as well.
Oh, fantastic.
Even though she's not
okay.
On the
I have two questions here. One, this is for your program. Were the women followed in active treatment programs like AA or NA during your study, and were there relapses?
They were. Among the group of women, I think we had, I'm trying to figure the figure, is it 40%?
Yeah.
40% by 12 months were using substances. So yes, we did have relapses. And we tracked, each time we talked to them, we asked them what kind of services they were getting. Were they using NA or AA? We also asked, were they back in treatment? So there was a pattern of people being in and out of treatment. And sometimes we could facilitate that in a way because they were telling us that they needed and they wanted resources. So yes, that did happen.
And then this question, Dr. Jerry, it's for you. How many patients are unable to get MAT help because of the constraints of Suboxone subscribing? Are they
subscribing?
Yeah.
Boy, that's a difficult question to know. I don't know that I've ever seen data on that because I think it's difficult to understand how many of those suffering from addictions would pursue Suboxone treatment if it were available. What I can tell you is that we all know that Suboxone is diverted on the streets, that there's a large market on the streets for illicit Suboxone. And it's not because Suboxone is a great drug of abuse. It isn't. And dollar for dollar, there are far better drugs out there if one's goal is to get high. So it's not really diverted for that reason. It's diverted because people use it when they can't get their drug of choice, or, and we hear this a lot, they use it when they can't get access to treatment, to legitimate treatment. When they don't have insurance or whatever, they buy the stuff off the streets in an effort to stay away from the needle. So I think sort of you could look at diverted Suboxone as being an indicator of how many more people are out there that you know would be seeing providers if they could get legitimate access.
Dr. Jerry, this would probably be for you also. When a person is in recovery and is on medicated-assisted treatment, how do we best help them learn to live a life as a sober person? I don't know if this is family or friend. You guys, from your model that you presented, all three panelists probably, you know.
Well, I think that's really what the 12 steps are all about. This isn't just about abstaining from whatever drug you were using. This is about learning life skills. It's about learning about all the underlying issues within you that contribute to your use. So, I think one of the misnomers is that when we talk about Suboxone and medication-assisted treatment that we're talking about, it's either medication-assisted treatment or the 12 steps or medication-assisted treatment or all these other things, and nothing could be further from the truth. It's both. It needs to be both. And, my patients on Suboxone recover just like everybody else. It's just that they also use medications.
Oh, I would just say, you know the quote that Lee read from the participant that said, I've got to have my dots connected, and if my son knows that I'm doing well by the company I keep. Before she said that statement, she said that she used to just lie about where she was going. And so when she left the house, her son knew that she was going to use, but she had all kinds of things that she would say. So she talked about becoming more honest and authentic in the relationship and how good that felt, you know, not to have to lie about where she's going. It was a very powerful moment when she described that. I think that relates to what we were talking about. That was a good question.
It's a great question, and I'll reiterate, it's about learning the new lifestyle, either through the 12 steps of AA and something similar, what are you replacing the substance use and the addiction with? And you need a plan, and you need something to bring that in, and learning how to leverage your support network in your favor and engaging them in your treatment as best as you can and as best as they're able.
This question is oriented towards your program again, too. Who were the women in the study? What was their drug of choice? And did their recovery differ if they were, I think, self-medicating because of trauma or underlying mental illness? Hold on, we have to turn it over. Does their recovery differ depending on their drug of choice? Examples would be marijuana, cocaine, heroin, spice, etc.
That's a great question. Can you find we have a hidden slide,
yes,
where we had a little bit of the statistics on who was in the study.
I can't pull it.
Yeah,
back up.
You can just read. You can okay. Just read it off.
Well, so the women who participated, 60% of them were African American, and 40% of them were white, and 40% of them had less than a high school education. And a large majority of them were what you would consider low income. The majority of them, 75%, had mental health disorders. And 89% of them had been exposed to trauma and had significant trauma symptomatology associated with that. And the majority, 57%, were dependent on cocaine.
I don't recall that we had any significant differences by type of drug. Lynn, if you could refresh my memory. We looked for that. We certainly looked for that. So many of the women had more than one substance that they were using. So the real thing for us is that the women who had dual disorders, who had the substance use disorder and a co-occurring mental health disorder, had a more difficult time achieving sobriety, and overall their quality of life was not as good. So one of the things we looked at was not just are they not using, it really relates to the question you just asked. It's not a matter of just not using. It's a matter of having a good quality of life. And the women had a lot of other issues, economic and related to trauma, that made just quality of life really hard. So I think it was the dual disorder group that we found over all of our analyses had the most trouble. You remember any from your lit review?
What's going to stand out to me tonight, of course, is it's the effects of trauma. It's the effects of trauma. It's going to trump everything. It's going to trump the mental illness. It's going to, drag down the quality of life and reduce the likelihood of positive outcomes in treatment. So you really have to address that trauma, and that's often also associated with shame and stigma and barriers in the network. And it's you got to get to the root of the trauma.
It was very interesting. In 2012, 2013, and I think 2014, we had a poison death review committee that involved physicians, involved mental health, law enforcement, public health, medical examiner, and a pharmacist. And it was interesting, we started getting into the data about probably about 32 to 34% of the individuals that died from a heroin overdose actually had a dual diagnosis. And I didn't, you know, when we first started getting into this, I'll never forget one of the first conferences that we held at the Cleveland Clinic in the Intercontinental. You know, you're down there in that bowl. I had a young African-American woman come up to me, and we were talking about education, parenting, and she said, you know, I enjoyed your presentation, but can I offer you a suggestion? And I said, well, if I'm offering suggestions, I need to take suggestions back. And she's, it's going to ruffle your feathers. And I said, that's no problem. And she says, you have to understand, when you're talking about parenting, a lot of children don't have two parents. And in many cases, you know, their upbringing is it's brutal. And their stepping stone to addiction is a mental health illness. And it was interesting to see when we started going back and looking at those cases, you know, the first couple months when we were on our poison death review, it was all professionals. It was people in the crowd. And then we started getting into some horrific history with young children and how they did have a mental health illness, and that was their stepping stone to addiction. So it's something we have to be very aware of. I think that's a very valid point. I guess this was, you know, this is, I don't know who this, throw this out there and we'll see who actually, you know, takes a crack at this one. A lot of people are in jail or prisons and are substance abusers. Why can't we defer that money from the jail to treatment programs? It's a good question.
Very good question. Well, I think we should. I'm very much in favor of consequences. I think consequences are a wonderful thing, actually. Legal consequences, I think, give us a tremendous opportunity to leverage those folks into treatment when those opportunities are available. I serve on Judge Mattia's county, excuse me, Common Pleas Drug Court Advisory Board, and I think, you know, I think Judge Mattia's program is a wonderful thing. I think it's a model for a tremendous opportunity that we have to get folks the treatment they need. Those people are very successful. I think sometimes, you know, people have the idea that, well, you have to want this when you go into treatment. This has to be your choice to come into treatment for it to be successful. And that's not true. There have been studies that have been done on that show that people who are forced into treatment by the courts do just as well as people who came in the front door voluntarily knowing that they needed help. So I'd love to see programs like Judge Mattia's program expand, and I think that would make far better use of taxpayer dollars than what we're doing now, which is it's just locking everybody up. And, you know, again, what something like 70% of our prison beds right now are occupied by people with drug offenses. So,
any suggestions? Any comments?
I think he said it.
Yeah, it's interesting when the state did come up. We had talked about, you know, the increase in the number of individuals who have entered our correctional facilities, and I was astounded at the number of women in the state of Ohio because of substance abuse and primarily the opioids. It's striking. You know, is there a better way that we can use our taxpayer dollars on the prevention side or treatment side? Because prevention or treatment works, we know that. We're going to have two individuals who are in long-term recovery the last session here that have been in recovery for a long time, and you have to support that, and I think that's important. Dr. Jerry, I heard from a couple of patients that they think they are ready to be, it looks like, weaned off methadone program. You as a physician, what do you take into consideration that would potentially choose not to take the patient off the program? Is there a protocol if the physician and the patient disagree?
Okay, I don't do methadone. I don't prescribe methadone. There are only two federally licensed methadone clinics here in the city of Cleveland, CTC and CAAA. But I'll answer that question from the vantage point of the patient that comes in and wants to wean off of Suboxone. The person who I would hesitate to wean off of Suboxone, I would still do it, but I would give them a little pushback and challenge their their thought about that is the person who's doing the bare minimum, who has been in the program, but you know, occasionally their urine tests positive for something that shouldn't be there. I really have to hound them and keep on their back about going to the minimum number of meetings. They don't yet have a sponsor, or they once had a sponsor, but they haven't talked to that sponsor in several months. That person is not going to do well. Again, we need to go back to the fact that only 10 to 20% of patients are successful without medications. Those aren't the 10 to 20%. The 10 to 20% are the ones that are really, really busting their butt in recovery.
You know, this question, when we talk to our partners across the state, some of the things we're looking at is, you know, what are some of the maybe the contributing factors that we're not addressing, especially when it comes to education? And I've heard from a lot of different people out there, and I'd like to ask the three of you to answer this. You know, not my kid, not my community is placing individuals and families not familiar with opioid abuse at risk. How would you work to educate individuals, families, and communities on the deadly nature of this disease?
First of all, not my kid, not my community. Yes, it is. I've treated people from every single suburb in this county. Not exaggerating, every single suburb. There is no safe haven anymore. There is no bubble, if you will. Every community is affected. And I think it goes back to, you know, I would say we need to focus more on this generalized permissive attitude towards mind-altering substance. You know, it seems to me that Yeah, I can't tell you the number of times that I've heard, well, you know, yeah, my kid's out there, you know, but at least he's just drinking, and he's just drinking, you know, with his friends and this and that and the other, but, you know, it's just alcohol. Or, you know, at least my kid's just smoking weed, and that's all. I don't think he's really into the hardcore drugs and that. You know, this all comes into play. I mean, in the end, addiction is addiction, and a lot of these things lead to other things, and you know, with the heroin problem specifically, most of this starts with prescription narcotics. Most of this starts, most of my patients, if you ask them, how did you get into heroin? How did you start doing that? Okay. It's not as you might think where, you know, they're at a party one night and they see somebody in the corner with a tourniquet on their arm and say, hey, you know, I think that looks like fun. I want to try that. It usually what they'll tell you is that, well, a few years ago I was in a car accident and I injured my knee and the doctor started me on Percocet. And, you know, after a couple of weeks on Percocet, I noticed that I started to like the way that made me feel. And I started to use more than the doctor was giving me. And then after running out of prescriptions early a couple of times, the doctor cut me off. And so I started obtaining it illicitly. And then I got to the point where I thought, why should I be spending $1 a milligram on Percocet when I can get heroin at a tenth of the cost? And I'll just be snorting it. I won't be shooting it. So it's really not that bad. So my point is, you know, look, I think we need to, and this goes back to, I think this, we've developed this culture both within hospitals and within the community at large that we need to be pain-free. You know, we need to be physically pain-free. We need to be mentally pain-free. And so, you know, when you go into a hospital these days and every time they check your vital signs, they ask you on a scale of 1 to 10, what's your pain level? I think that sets up some expectations that maybe you ought to be pain-free. And I think we've become that way. I think we need to push back more now. As consumers and citizens, we need to push back. When we go into the doctor's office, don't be so quick to accept that prescription for a narcotic. You know, a lot of the times, something like Motrin will work just as well. Actually, if not better in a lot of ways, because it's also an anti-inflammatory. But, you know, for things like tooth extractions and, you know, having arthroscopic knee surgery and that, these are things that can really be managed quite well with Motrin and really don't need a narcotic. So I think, you know, learning that pain, physical pain is a part of life. The older we get, certainly the more sore we're going to be when we wake up in the morning. You know, I heard somebody once say that, you know, when I'm completely pain-free, if I wake up and I'm completely pain-free, I'm going to run and check the obituaries to see if my name is there. But I think it's true. And, you know, I've
I don't know if you've noticed that, but I don't have a morning that I get up that I don't feel some amount of pain from, you know, several years of wrestling when I was younger. It's just part of life, and I think we need to. I'd rather deal with some physical pain than deal with some of the stuff that my patients are dealing with as a result of narcotics addictions.
I think you said it very, very well. I think that forums like this are important. I think the more we read in the newspaper and stories get out, I think that helps dispel this myth that it's someone else that this is affecting.
And just to build on that, and I'll speak from my personal most recent experiences dealing with my family member who's having an addiction and how to engage the other family members, primarily this is my cousin, and how to engage his parents and to have those more difficult conversations for the past 3 years haven't been happening. And if they're not reading the newspaper, how do I leverage social media? Mm-hmm. And, you know, stimulate some of that. What can I share in forums that are safe, less intimidating, and maybe kind of skirt some of the stigma? And so if I have a Facebook presence, it's generally sharing things about addiction that my family don't want to talk about. And certainly they don't want to hear from me as a professional on it or anything like that. But on Facebook, it's how can I reach them in whatever way I can to dispel the myths and the stigma and the shame.
I think the last question that we're going to take here is, please describe how this public health crisis has changed your work or your views on the field of recovery.
I've kind of spoke to this already, but when I first started off in the field 13 years ago, right out of residency, I worked at one of the traditional 28-day treatment programs that I spoke of before up in the West Palm Beach area in Florida. And I really became hardcore abstinence-based. I really thought that was the only way, and that, you know, methadone and Suboxone, that's cheating. You know, that's just not right. And I lost a lot of patients. I lost a lot of patients over the years. And a lot of them were pretty soon after being discharged from the treatment facility. And that really wore on me after a while and got me thinking about other approaches to addiction treatment, and really got me digging into the literature regarding methadone and Suboxone and treatment outcomes in that. And I changed over time. And now, obviously, doing what I'm doing up here, I'm very immersed in medication-assisted treatment. Again, you know, ultimately, I think abstinence is a noble goal, but I think there's a tremendous level of commitment that it takes for one to get to that point where they'll be successful. And I'm sick of seeing people die before they get it. Anyway, that's one major way. The other major way, which I told you before, is in treating pregnant women. It was an area that I avoided for years, and then being at the Cleveland Clinic, I thought, you know, if we can't take care of pregnant women here at the Cleveland Clinic, who can? I had an older mentor in our program, Dr. Collins, who's since left, who had been treating pregnant women. So I thought, well, hey, if I run into any hitches, he can back me up and guide me through this process. And so it became, again, one of the most gratifying areas of practice for me. And now I see moms walking in with kids that are 3 and 4 years old, 5 years old, and I treated them throughout their pregnancy. And it's so cool to see those kids who otherwise might not be here if not for the opportunity for their mom to engage in treatment. That's a really cool thing for me. So,
I think one thing for me, it just has an urgency to the work. It makes me realize how important this is. It is very hard for the women that we talk with to mobilize a recovery-oriented support network. It's not an easy thing to do, but yet I can see that it's so important. One thing I do in my teaching is I try to get what we call prior knowledge. You know, what do students know or think about this topic? And I think that's very helpful to get at some of the negative attitudes that some of our students might have, so that we can have them be more professional and go with the social work values that we want them to be carrying with them.
So mine is kind of the balance between the urgency and the need to really understand what's going on. And we were talking about this earlier, and I'm really interested in, and why are some people successful and some aren't? And what is happening in those folks who are able to maintain lasting recovery from severe addiction? And so along with understanding how social support networks function in recovery, I'm interested in how they make you feel inside and how that builds on your ability to be confident in your sobriety.
Watch for her dissertation.
Forthcoming dissertation.
Forthcoming dissertation.
It's a page turner.
I think in closing for me, what I've seen, it's something that I haven't experienced outside of this crisis, is, it's the first time in my career that I can really say that medicine, law enforcement, public health, the recovery community, we're all working towards a common goal, and I've never experienced that. And, we started out with our coalition, there were six people. If you come to one of our meetings these days, there's over 50 people in the room. And mind you, it changes and it fluctuates. But the nice thing is there are people here today that participate. I know that they can call them. I enjoy getting a call from somebody that's putting in a recovery house, Aaron Helms. Hey, I got this idea. We need more of that. I enjoy working with those mayors in these communities that understand that, just because you have, gated communities and there's beautiful flowers, you still have a problem. And they ask us to come in and talk about those issues. When I come across a young law enforcement officer who comes to my office to get naloxone and says, hey, I didn't want to carry this kit 2 years ago. I've saved three people. I get it now. I get it. So we talk about changing stigma, changing that view, and that's kind of what really drives me. So I it's been great. I want to thank all of you for coming today. I think we're going to have a closing comment, but if you could, a round of applause for our panelists, please.
So on behalf of the Siegel Lifelong Learning Program, Case Western Reserve University, I want to thank all of our panelists. Thank Vince for your commitment to do this. And among the sectors of the community that you say are participating in finding solutions, I'm pleased that our program, the university, and everyone who joins us can be part of that as well. I want to remind everyone, you see that we're recording these sessions. Please let people know who couldn't attend that they'll be available on our website. I want to thank our partners at MediaVision for helping us out in this regard. And of course, thanks to Cheryl and Denny for all of your hard work in making this happen. So our next session is next week, and thank you for joining us. Good night.